1997. What a night. What a document. What a boring waste of time. Still, it's a good budget. If you're a Canberra-dwelling, world-class, athletic, native, fauna-loving, Thursday's not good for me, pensioner. But a lousy one if you happen to be a disabled, chain-smoking meat inspector who needs a lot of childcare. To save on money for the disabled will be reassessed. Some will be reassessed as not being disabled. Hallelujah! Praise the treasurer! They're cured! They're cured! But what about that savings incentive? If you manage to not spend 60 grand and put it in the bank, you'll eventually save $450! $450! Now John Howard says he won't take advantage of the savings rebate, which has forced the tax office to bring out a special prime ministerial tax form at a cost to every taxpayer of about $450. In more interesting news, Susie Moroney, champion! The first person ever to swim from Cuba to the United States. Susie rested briefly every hour and was fed high-protein baby food. This actually slowed her down because her mother had to give her each spoonful with, "Here comes the little aeroplane!" The RSPCA may charge Melbourne's Crown Casino with cruelty to animals after a release of doves at the opening celebrations went horribly wrong. Some birds flew straight into a 15-metre flame and were killed instantly. Others survived the flames but fell into the Yarra and drowned. Casino patrons immediately started betting on whether the doves would come down red or black. So the casino singes a couple of birds and it's a tragedy. But when it takes your life savings, it's an exciting economic resurgence for Melbourne. A country New South Wales school has been banned from performing the traditional Easter play about the death of Christ. The play contains scenes of Jesus being whipped, spat on and humiliated. And the education department says it can't be staged in its present form again. To get around this, students will perform the play as an inter-school rugby league match. Where beating, spitting and humiliation are perfectly acceptable. Chess wizard Garry Kasparov has been done over by the world's most powerful computer, Deep Blue 2. Kasparov didn't stand a chance. Deep Blue 2 is more like a chess grandmaster than Deep Blue 1. IBM even programmed in bad dress sense and a stuffed social life. For winning the contest, the supercomputer will take home $900,000. It plans to head to the nearest red light district and treat itself to a laptop. And that's the good news.
It's good news week. Someone's dropped a bomb somewhere, contaminating atmosphere and blackening the sky. It's good news week. Someone found a way to give the rotting dead a will to live. Go on and never die. It's good news week.
Thank you, good evening. Joining me in the Enterprise Bargain Basement tonight, the industrial action man, Mikey Robbins, Miss Rolling Stoppages, 1997, Kate Fisher, and the card-carrying, placard-waving, motion-moving Adam Spencer. And they're locked in a demarcation dispute with the amalgamated Julie McCrossan, the federated James O'Loughlin, and the Brotherhood of Rod Quantock. All right, brothers and sisters, would someone second a motion?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you. Mikey, Kate, Adam, what's the story here?
Right, just a look. That's an aeroplane, Paul.
Yep, nice. Group of people.
Yes,
group
under an aeroplane.
97.
That's a man who can't get an overall to fit him.
Oh, goodness.
Back end of a plane.
At the back of a plane.
Someone going, oh, that's the engine, should keep that there, could come in handy.
It's about Qantas, who are known as the Flying Kangaroo.
Are they laying people off?
Left, right and centre.
Left, right and centre. They're doing so much laying, I'm going to get out of that right now. There's a bunch of apprentices, a couple of dozen, not that many, not enough. who got to the end of their apprenticeship, we believe, and Qantas said, look, thanks for the past 2.5 years of your life, now get staffed.
See you later. I personally can't see what these guys are complaining about. It's not like they'd actually done a job, they're only apprentices. Mm. Qantas have been good enough to give them 2.5 years to prove themselves, because it's scabs like you that are running this country into the bloody ground, mate.
I couldn't agree with you more, Adam. In fact, I say put the children back down the mines.
Yeah. 3 points.
Thank you.
After getting rid of 132 apprentices and maintenance staff in the last 2 weeks, Qantas now says up to 20% of its entire workforce may be retrenched. Jobs have been cut so savagely that Qantas is even replacing the flying kangaroo logo with a tin of pet food. But the sack staff have been told to look on the bright side. They may be unemployed now, but in a couple of years, lots of jobs will open up in the crash investigation industry. I still call Australia home. Mainly because I'm too scared to get on the plane. Julie James Rod shed a little light on this.
A street with a bank in it?
That is in Bendigo. I've been there.
Well, that's a Victoria. Look at him.
Oh, dear.
Funny I can't afford haircuts.
Now, oh, that's obvious.
Yeah. This would be...
Why bother when it's so patently clear? 3 points.
Way to see you. Almost had me there, Roger. You clever bugger, you.
Ooze confidence.
Isn't this to do with your premier down in Victoria, an extraordinary haircut, a commitment to sidewalk cafes, and he's linking it to the banking industry?
Yes, what happens now in Victoria when you go to an ATM?
Auto bank.
And you press in your PIN number.
Yeah.
If it ends...
What's that, Rob?
Rob. 3204.
Right.
That's my number!
I wonder why that one broke. Look, will you listen to me? I'm trying to splain. Splain away, Rod. What happens there when you go to the ITM in Victoria, you put in your PIN number?
There's an ITM, you brainless goose.
That's becoming apparent.
This is the ABC. It caters for people like me.
What they're doing is the Victorian government is making the banks pay for the rental of the sidewalk outside the ATM because all those people are having such a top time there just waiting in line.
It's not actually the Victorian government, though.
No, well, obviously it's not the Victorian government.
No, it's actually the Bendigo Council itself.
Rod Fife.
Rod Fife in person was doing that. Yeah. But not only that, now with the ATMs, when you press in your PIN number in Victoria, you don't get that little thing that says key in amount. Some little wheels go around.
Yeah.
And if you get 3 cherries in a row, they take all the money in your bank account.
And 3 points. Bendigo Council wants to charge the big banks rent for footpath space near automatic teller machines. The banks, of course, say the council charge is greedy, unjust and discriminatory. And it's a good thing they can pass it straight on to their customers. Which is the only fun they really have in the banking industry, apart from covering themselves in honey and rolling naked in all the money. Before the show, while we were picking on a few scabs, both teams were given 3 clues to a recent strange but true story. Robbins, Fisher and Spencer received a donut.
It's still whole.
An ATM card.
Yeah.
And a goose. And McCrossan, O'Loughlin and Quantop got a tiny pair of tweezers, a tiny hypodermic syringe, and a flea. Yes, it's funny and it's cheap. Round two kicks off with Good News Roulette. Kate, 3 headlines from the Wagga Wagga Daily Advertiser. 1 is real, 2 are fake. Find the real headline, okay? Here we go. We have Steel Roof impresses home judges. Pottery Champ spins heads at craft show. And fundraising ball to auction signed Mark Taylor bat.
Gee, Wagga Wagga's an exciting place.
It is, actually.
I don't know. I mean, maybe not even in Wagga Wagga they'd be dumb enough to auction a signed bat by Mark Taylor. They wouldn't score many runs off it.
Mind you, though, wasn't Mark Taylor born in Wagga Wagga?
Wagga boy.
He's a Wagga boy. He's a Wagga Wagga boy.
Well, gee,
I've never thought of Wagga Wagga as the steel roof capital of Australia.
No.
But please don't let us influence you.
No.
It's your question. Don't have to listen to the
chirps,
boys.
Spins, heads at craft show. Geez, I'm stumped.
I'd pursue that stump line.
Stumps, bales.
Stump,
yeah. No.
Don't bail out now that you're stumped. You aren't. We don't want this question to slip through our fingers because, golly, that'd be bad.
I'm going for the number one.
Oh, Jesus.
Well, I'm glad to see that Kate has finally followed her heart. Let's see if you're right. Yes! Yeah! Absolutely. 2 points.
Did you like our clever diversion there?
Yes.
You never thought we'd get it, did you?
No.
No. Yes, judges at the recent Excellence in Housing Awards were mighty impressed with a lightweight steel roof. Oh, yes. So not much really does happen in Wagga. Now I'm thinking, here are some judges who should get out a little more. I mean, it's a roof, right? It's a roof and it's made of steel. What is so impressive about that? A roof made from little leftover bits of soap. Now that would be impressive. Or a roof thatched from pubic hair. Now you're talking. Channel 7. Channel 7, maybe there's a show in it. Australia's least impressive home improvements. James, 3 headlines now for you from that fine journal, The Weekly World News. Giant tapeworms attack Spanish village. I saw the face of Jesus in my gumbo. Or water found on moon is astronaut pee.
Well, I don't think it could be water found on moon is astronaut pee because, you know, this is a small step for mankind, but a big pee for me. It wouldn't really work because, you know, you unzip your fly, start doing a pee, and all of a sudden you're dead.
What they've developed from the space race up on the moon is that they had a tube inside the suit, and you know when they can I do you know how when they were walking on the moon like that, it was nothing to do with gravity. Their pants were full of
pee. They were full.
Anyway, that's not here nor there. Cross out number 3. Right. Gone.
The giant tapeworms attacked Spanish village. That was true because the giant tapeworms kept eating things because some of them had people inside them.
El grosso tapeworm-o.
We reckon it's number 2 because last time he was on, do you remember there was a croissant that had the face of Mother Teresa in it? No, so it's a bit of a theme over here.
Yeah. It was a bun. So you're going for number 2.
I'd like it to be number 1 because I think the Spanish deserved that after the Civil War, but we'll go for number 2.
Don't you love a man who's still passionate about the Spanish Civil War? I love this man!
Okay. Two.
Who's it? Bottom line, let's see it. Let's see what...
The Lord's not coming back in a gumbo. I'll stop buying them.
According to the Weekly World News, and who could doubt them, NASA has admitted that frozen liquid found on the moon came from astronauts who had to relieve themselves. NASA is refusing to reveal the identity of the astronauts. They're also refusing requests for the photographs of the frozen wee. Apparently, the astronauts wrote their names.
I was imagining that. Buzz, I told you, you should have gone before we left.
Are we there yet?
If you don't stop the module, we'll do it. Sorry?
To close round 2, Bites. Adam, what is this man talking about?
We thought to mark that centenary, we could at least give some community infrastructure of lasting benefit.
Oh,
isn't that sweet?
Why don't you get him on the show? He's good, isn't he?
That's Peter Costello offering to leave some community infrastructure of lasting benefit, which is sweet of him because I was actually quite happy with the infrastructure we had a year ago, like hospitals and an ABC.
Who needs care for the age when you can have nice shiny flagpoles?
Exactly.
In fact, instead of putting men in a home, why not paint her as the Australian flag and run her up a pole? She's skinny, she'll flap in the wind.
What it's actually about is the Libs have set up something called the Federation Fund. It's a $1 billion public fund to build national monuments of lasting significance, i.e. flagpoles and things like that, to celebrate the year 2000.
Yeah, and 2001, which will be the centenary of Federation, hence the term Federation.
Well caught there, Mikey.
Adam's answer's correct.
Federation fun, flagpole in the backyard. Thank you, Pete.
Yep.
2 points, let's hear it, go Wild!
The budget has set aside a $1 billion fund to be run by the Prime Minister to mark the centenary of Federation in the year 2001. The government has already identified sacred sites where the Federation fund should be especially allocated. They're called marginal electorates. And every state will have their own special Federation project. Victoria will construct a 50-storey high statue of Jeff Kennett with a revolving restaurant in the head. I won't even tell you where the car park is.
She's got that.
And in Queensland, in recognition of 100 years of world trade, a big Australian farmer will be built, being lowered onto the rough end of the big pineapple. Rod, your bite. Rod.
Paul.
No, it's just a word. Rod.
just a word, isn't it?
Okay, I'm ready. From a well-known Cheryl.
Okay.
Where is the evidence that the way it is at the moment, it's not working for Australia?
Oh, it's a hair.
Are you allowed to pass?
Rod, have you noticed that in Australia at the moment, we've got too much diversity of first name of major media owners? We've got Kerry Stokes, Kerry Packer,
and Kerry Murdoch. Rupert's just a trick he's playing on it.
Hey, is it just me, or does Lachlan Murdoch look like the puppet that used to drive Thunderbird 4?
Oh, yeah.
It's okay, Dad's got brains working on the formula. We can fix this media policy.
This lass, what worries me about this poor woman is she still thinks that federal policy is based on evidence. But I'm sorry, I'll give you the floor.
What she's talking about here is the fact that we have a diverse media ownership, which is part of that is Kerry. I don't like to because.
Say it.
Kerry Packer, that bastard Kerry Packer.
Don't hold back.
Because
Rod, we're pretty sure some of his family are going to be watching this.
That's right.
Why do you think they'd be...
Can we have an answer?
The
answer is she is talking about media diversity in Australia and she's saying that it's working perfectly well and why should we concentrate media ownership and cave into Kerry Packer's lust for the Fairfax Empire direct on all of us and we'll all have nothing left and the newspapers will all be owned by Kerry Packer and they've taken $55 million off the ABC. Did you know what John Howard said about the ABC? He said we should take money off the ABC because it doesn't have a representative right-wing voice on the ABC. The ABC couldn't balance the right-wing voice in the media if it was run by Marx and Lenin. And now they want it. Oh, it's depressing. It's depressing.
I'll be all right, Paul. I'll be all right.
Cheryl was talking about media policy and sort of saying, why change it?
That's what I said in a roundabout way.
2 points and 1 point for the passion. Total of 3. Coalition backbenchers have warned the government that it may take weeks or even months before they can agree to any changes to the cross-media laws. I hope they don't leave it too long. James Packer wants Fairfax for Christmas. Well, what do you give the boy who's got everything? But it's sad to think James has to go on national television to tell his dad what he wants for Christmas.
They are very nice guys. I just want to say that. They are very nice guys.
Yes. And now that we've been warm and Christian, loving and caring, let's get back to the nasty stuff. Changing the media laws will only hurt the little people. Little people like Kerry Stokes. It was only disgustingly rich, not obscenely rich. Of course, the government's media policy is in sharp contrast to the opposition's. The ALP policy is to see how far up Rupert Murdoch they can get before the canary dies. John Howard says he hasn't decided whether the current media owners are too powerful. He'll have to wait to read tomorrow's papers to see what he thinks. Checking the scores now, Robbins Limited are carving up the company on 7 points. While Macrossan Holdings bully the government on 6 points. Round three is the occasionally confusing odd one out. Adam, Kate, Mikey, we have for you rugby league star Eric Sims.
All hail! Yeah.
Swimmer Dennis Pankratov.
He's upset about something.
Tiger Woods.
He's bloody rich.
He's very at ease. Doesn't
and
dress well, but very
Greg Norman.
Okay, let me say this from the outset. If it was passion that got the points for Rod, I just want to say that Eric Sims was the most talented footballer to ever strap on a boot. And with the tremendous South Sydney teams of the late 60s who lost to Balmain in an absolute upset in 1969.
We don't talk about 69.
And then he won the grand final in 1971 by kicking field goals.
It's like being in the Packer household, isn't it, with those two guys?
Fine.
There was a lot of shouting there, and I thought, you know, because they're lovely guys and stuff, and they talk about sport.
It's fine.
They talk about rugby. You know, people would, wouldn't they? You started this. You started this.
I came back to it. It's a winning with rules thing. Eric Sims.
Eric Sims. They changed the field goal rule from 2 points
to 1 point because he's such a legend, such a god.
Dennis Pankratov does all the underwater swimming
in the backstroke before he surfaces. Oh, actually, no, he's just freestyle there.
That's an unusual backstroke. That one, breaststroke.
They're going to maximise the distance you can go underwater.
Yeah.
Tiger Woods is playing so well, they're thinking of restructuring the fairways to make it more difficult for him.
Actually, they are also thinking of making him play with Klansmen.
That sort of stuff.
Just to and slow him down a bit.
Greg Norman.
But poor Greg is he's a bit of a choker, really.
That's the thing.
He's choking on something there.
Greg Norman's the only sportsman on that list who can lose purely through his own ability and doesn't need to
Greg.
Exactly.
Well, 3 points for you.
Yes! Yay.
Hell, I don't know. I never paid.
What about the passion?
Stella! Stella!
Hell. Yeah, one.
Oh, look, I have to start abusing what? Rod's family in law to what? Get the point.
Oh, mate.
Give me the point!
Did you say family in law? In law? Did you say in law? Did you come?
Get long-winded. You know, I'm not very good with words, modelling career. Give me the point, McDermott.
All right, Fisher, here it comes. One big point for your passion. Thank you.
Hey, I tell you what, old Jimbo don't know what he's in for.
Oh, yes, he does, Mikey.
He thinks Dad's scary. I've got a funny feeling. Who's going to run in this country in 10 years' time? Ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. You watch it. Yeah.
Give me the network. Give me the network. I want the paper. Give me the paper. Give me New Zealand. I want New Zealand and Timor.
Yes, it is Greg Norman, but we don't care anymore. Because they don't have to change the rules to stop him winning. Some of golf's leading players want rule changes so they don't have their sorry asses whipped by Tiger Woods every time they step onto a golf course. But if you want to stop Tiger driving so far, what about furry balls and Velcro fairways? Rod, James, Julie, who's the supermodel in a huff here? We have, for your enjoyment, Richard Gere, Prince Charles, the Pope, and Nicole Kidman.
Isn't that cruel?
Oh, the Pope picks his own hat. Let him go for it.
Nicole Kidman, Scientology, wacky, weird, lots of questions, don't really understand it. Poor chap there, son of the Queen, Church of England, bland, uninteresting religion. Chap with the red hat, never forgive him as Pope.
for that shocking policy on contraception. Richard Gere
doesn't have a policy on contraception.
To my knowledge, he doesn't have a policy on contraception. He's tremendously giving in that regard.
Have we got an answer? Is there an answer forthcoming?
Yes, the only one that hasn't had an affair with Richard Gere is Nicole Kidman.
No points for anybody.
No.
Nothing. No. It's the Pope.
Why?
He's still happy with the religion he was born with. Richard Gere became a Buddhist, right? Yeah. Nicole Kidman, Scientology. Yes. And Prince Charles has been flirting with...
Spice Girls.
Prince Charles has been thinking of converting to Islam after it was revealed he likes to read the Quran and lounge around in traditional Middle Eastern robes.
Oh,
huh?
Right. Okay, fine.
Yes?
You're telling me that the son of the head of my Anglican faith is thinking of converting?
In our country, but...
Well, why can't Charles defect to Islam? I mean, Charles knows he probably won't be King of England, so maybe he's planning to become the Shah of Wales or the Ayatollah of Edinburgh. But if he's had so much trouble with one wife, how's he going to deal with four? Mikey, Kate, Adam, your strange but true clues were the donut, the ATM card, and the goose.
Fail, he's eating the props.
Kate, you got any ideas? I think the Canadian thing's the giveaway. Could you pass the goose down to me, please, Adam? It's a very skinny goose.
You're on national TV, Mikey.
It's a very, There was a baker in Canada, and a bloke was desperate to perpetrate a crime. Desperate, but he didn't want to really hurt anyone. He was like a gentle robber. For a start, he's robbing a bakery, which either makes him gentle or stupid.
Very hungry.
Or very hungry. So he thought, okay, what's the best way to get money out of people without hurting them? Take hostages. I can't really do that. So he took a goose hostage, walked into a bakery.
It's a true story.
And said, hand over all the money, or the goose gets it. And they looked at him and they said, shoot the goose, what a week here. In fact, don't just shoot it, we'll get some bread down first and some salad. Bloke tried to hold up a bakery using a goose as a hostage in Canada.
You're right.
Thank you.
Police in Toronto are looking for a man who walked into a donut shop carrying a goose recently and said, give me some money or I'll kill the goose. The good thing about goose holdups is they only happen 6 months of the year because all the weapons fly south for the winter. In an unrelated incident, a man has escaped from a Montreal jail after carving a bar of soap into a mallard. Julie James Rod, your strange but true story is pinned to the tiny tweezers, syringe and flea.
It's actually interestingly to do with the New South Wales Royal Commission into Police Corruption. Recent report come down and Justice Wood had the bravery to argue for limited decriminalisation of personal use. This is going to be trialled on a small family of ACT fleas who are going to be allowed to inject small quantities of heroin into their system just to see if family life can be maintained. And in the ACT it can. It's well known most of the ACT are in fact on smack.
Well, tender plate.
Yes.
It's a new Australian invention where we've found out a way of tagging insects, right, by injecting this stuff into them.
They're tagging them because they want to know what sex they are, because sexing a very small thing. If you've been watching Alien Nation, you're not in possession of a very large camera, thank you, you are.
Yeah,
it can be very, very. Can you see the sex of your flea? Open its legs with these tweezers.
All right, so will you do that? Because I'm holding the flea. There we go.
Okay, James. What sex?
Inject it now. There we go.
By injecting it with this special Australian scientific fluid.
This one's reading Playboy. I think it's a male.
It's a male.
So we inject them all. So we know we're Australian. We inject them with beer. And so Pauline Hanson can then find out all the non-Australian fleas that have just come over here and stolen our fleas, John.
Philip Zaki.
That's right, Philip Zaki, and then send them back.
You're right. Thank you.
It's over.
An Australian engineer and an Australian entomologist have invented the fallow blaster, an automated device for inflating the genitalia of dead insects. The genitalia are the key to separating different but closely related species, and scientists previously had to inflate them by hand. And unless you're very careful, a lot can go wrong. Now, I'd say when you start shooting pure alcohol into dead flies' dicks for a living, a lot has already gone wrong. You know, it's funny, really. Pump alcohol into the genitalia of a human being and it's straight into the asylum. Do it to an insect and they'll probably give you a Nobel Prize. The bad news is insects are playing dead to have their genitals inflated. Just to impress the ladybugs. Mikey Robbins, Kate Fisher and Adam Spencer scored a creepy, crawly 14 points. Tasting sweet victory over Julie McCross and James O'Loughlin and Rod Quantock on a venomous 10 points. So we say thank you to the rank and file and leave you with the good news that Susie Maroney has entered the Guinness Book of Records for the fourth time after her 25-hour swim from Cuba to Florida. And she would have been even quicker if she hadn't been towing 34 Cubans in inner tubes. Right, everybody out.
Everybody out.
Everybody out.